Well, whether we realize it or not, we are all on the search for it. And the search for it consumes us. It consumes a ton of our time, and it consumes a ton of our attention. The search for it influences the decisions that we make, the places that we go, and the people that we hang around. We search for it in a number of different ways. Probably the primary way that we search for it is through relationships. Because here's the deal, relationships of all different kinds, even unhealthy relationships provide some level of it. That's the reason why, you think about young boys whenever they join a gang, and you think to yourself, now why in the world, would a young kid willingly enter into a dangerous, destructive, and life-threatening situation? And the reason is because in a very real way, gangs provide it. Especially when someone is brought up in a broken home that doesn't have love and support, right? It's the same reason why a young girl will stay with a guy that treats her like dirt. Everybody around that young lady can tell them over and over and over, hey, this guy is no good for you. This guy is just using you. You could do so much better, and you know, et cetera, et cetera. But she'll end up staying with the guy, and the reason is because on some level, that relationship provides it. Apart from relationships, we try to find it through acquiring money. We try to find it through accumulating stuff. We search for it by seeking out admiration or approval from other people. We look for it in sports, in academics. Our lives are basically, this is the picture that I'm trying to paint for you, our lives are basically a constant search for it. The majority of our media, television, movies, books, they're all about the search for it. It is very difficult to define sometimes. It can take many names, many shapes, many forms. Last week we talked about it in terms of success, that we all are looking for success. But for our purposes today, I want us to define it by this term. Security. We're all looking for security. It's like wired into our DNA somehow that we are looking for it. We are looking for that security. We need to feel secure. Realize it or not, our security motivates us every day of our lives. We all have a need and a desire to feel safe and protected. I think I mentioned this last week, how one of our neighbors, caught somebody trying to break into their house, right? Well, here's the deal. For several days after that, we were going the extra mile to make sure and check every door, make sure every door was locked, every window was locked. We wanted to make sure that we were safe. We were even leaving the porch light on all night, you know, there for a few days, right? Because it's uncomfortable to have that feeling of insecurity. Our need for security leads us, it shapes us, and it guides us even when we don't even realize it. And so the question that we want to answer today is the search for security a valid search? Do we, in fact, truly need to seek out security? So we are in week 2 of our short 4-week series on the Psalms of Ascent. So kids, if you are paying attention, what kind of psalms are we talking about? We're talking about the Psalms of Ascent, right? And so our psalm today focuses on this need of security that we have and the search for security that we're on. So here's the deal. If you got your Bible, I want you to turn with me to Psalm number 125. Psalm number 125, it is a short psalm like most of the Psalms of Ascents are, but it's also a very strong declaration of where our security is found. And so let's read it together, Psalm chapter 125. Starting in verse 1, it says, "Those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be shaken but endures forever. As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people, both now and forevermore. The scepter of the wicked will not remain over the land allotted to the righteous, for then the righteous might use their hands to do evil. Lord, do good to those who are good, to those who are upright in heart, but to those who turn to crooked ways, the Lord will banish with the evildoers." And then he ends by saying, "Peace be on Israel." And so again, this psalm is a very strong declaration that our security is and should be only found in the Lord. Our security is found in the reality that God is with his people. Can I tell you something? My head right now just feels like it's about this big. Not because I think that much of myself, but it feels like it's about to explode, right? Can I tell you something? As bad as I feel, and as much as I feel like sitting down right now and letting somebody else preach, God is with me. In the midst of every storm that you have, God is with you, right? And that is where our security is found. Look at verses 1 and 2 again. It says, "Those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be shaken but endures forever. As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people both now and forevermore." You can see our desire for security in a lot of different ways in our culture. You could see our desire for security in the way we construct our societies, in the way we construct our cities. If you look throughout history, you'll notice something about when, especially kind of in ancient times, when they were building cities, when they were constructing cities, they would always try to build cities on top of big hills, right? Well, the reason you would build a city on top of a hill is because it provided amazing security. With large slopes all the way around you, if somebody was going to invade, they would have to journey up to where you are. And when they get there, you're looking down on them, and so there's an immediate advantage there from a military standpoint. Think about how the high ground helps during war. Why do you think George Washington moved the troops outside Philadelphia in 1777 to Valley Forge? Any history buffs? No history buffs. Okay, so Valley Forge is elevated, and Washington from that point could keep an eye on the British. Valley Forge provided geographical security. And so that's what's going on in Jerusalem. If you know anything about Jerusalem and the lay of the land there, Jerusalem is built on a high elevation. It was a wonderful place for security reasons. And actually, if you look at the way Jerusalem was structured, it was kind of built on this elevation, and then right next to Jerusalem, there was this drop-off. There was this incredible valley. But then right after the valley, there's this really high, tall mountains, even higher than Jerusalem. And that valley with those mountains kind of provided a natural security fence, a natural barrier for Jerusalem. And what the psalmist is doing here is he's taken this well-known idea of geographical security of Jerusalem, and he's saying that's the type of security that God provides for us. As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people. The psalmist says, we find our security in Christ alone. Now let's personalize this a little bit. Do you believe that the Lord surrounds you? That's easy to say in church, isn't it? Right? We're in church. Praise God, the Lord surrounds me. But what about when life is crashing down around you? Do you believe the Lord surrounds you? That wherever you go as a child of God, whatever circumstances comes your way, that God is with you and that you are safe in him. Theology of God's presence is one of the most important themes of the Bible. But it is so easy for us to forget, and it is so easy for us to overlook. You know, when trials and tribulations and difficulties of life comes, we find ourselves asking, where are you, God? I mean, why aren't you helping me right now? I need you now more than ever. I was just watching a TV show with my wife just a couple of days ago, and this lady on TV, it's a drama, kind of one of those pull at your heartstrings kind of TV shows. And on the TV show, this lady found out that she's got cancer, and she kind of snapped at her husband, took a walk. She went to church and sat down and just said, God, this wasn't part of the deal. Like, right? Like we can make deals with God, but this wasn't part of the deal, God. Like, I need you right now. Why are you doing this to me? But can I tell you something? The problem is not a presence problem. God will always be present with his people, both now and forevermore, right? The problem is not a presence problem. The problem is an awareness problem. It is the fact that we are not aware of God's presence. We are not aware of God's protection. We are not aware of God's security. And one of the most important things that we can do is exactly what Psalm 125 speaks of. It speaks of the reality that the Lord is with his people both now and forevermore. And as we read the psalm, we are becoming increasingly aware of God's presence in our lives. And when we become aware of God's presence, it'll change the way we live. When I woke up at 7 a.m. and I wanted to throw my phone across the room because it was beeping at me, telling me to get up, and I didn't feel like it, God was with me in that moment. When we have gone through some of the most difficult trials in our lives, God was with us. When we realize that God is with us, it'll change the way we live. And here's the deal. I don't just mean that, you know, kids, when you realize dad's watching you over, you know, his shoulder, it changes the way you behave. I'm not just talking about that, right? I mean, it's going to change this never-ending search for security that we have. It'll change the way we go to work and the reason why we go to the work and the reason why we work. It'll change the places that we go and we try to fill this need to be secure. It'll change the people that we hang around. It'll change the way we interact with people. You ever interacted with somebody and it's like, holy cow, you just keep bragging on yourself. It's almost like you're trying to convince me that I should like you. Well, when we're secure in Christ, we don't need that approval from other people. Psalm 125 speaks to us directly that our security is found in one place and one place alone, and that is in the reality that God is present with his people now and forevermore. But here's the deal. Psalm 125 doesn't give this flowery view that because God is present with his people, everything's always going to be hunky-dory and we're never going to have to face difficulties or challenges, right? Look at verse 3 and 4 with me. We'll even go to verse 5. These three verses here reflect the reality that evil is in the world despite of God's presence. Look at verse 3. The scepter of the wicked will not remain over the land allotted to the righteous, for then the righteous might use their hands to do evil. Lord, do good to those who are good, but to those who are upright in heart, but to those who turn to crooked ways, the Lord will banish with evildoers. So the reality is, even though God is present, we live in a very insecure world. We live in a dangerous world. Think about all the circumstances that lead to these feelings of insecurities. The way our culture is changing brings about insecurity, doesn't it? I remember back in the 90s when I started working for my dad in the auto parts store. Back in those days when somebody would call in for a part, we had this massive catalog section, right? And I had to memorize, somebody called in for brake pads, I had to memorize where to go in that catalog section and start looking things up. Well, a couple of years into working there, our supplier got computer systems. Ooh, that completely wrecked my father, right? He didn't know what to do. It brought about insecurity, just a little bit of change. And I remember being this teenage boy, getting ready to hit my 20s, and thinking, why are you freaking out? It's just a computer, right? Well, now that I'm 40 years old, as things change, it freaks me out. The way our culture changes brings about security. The way our culture changes the values in our nation, the way they seem to be just going down the tubes, that brings about insecurity. Change in technology, when changes happen so much and so frequently and so quickly, it brings about insecurity. But it's not just change that brings insecurity. We've got to face the stark reality that there are people out there that want to do us harm. And I mean that on an individual level. I mean that on a national level, and I mean that as a church, as the church as well, that there are people that are against us. Individually, there are people who will talk about you behind your back. I mean, when you're face to face with them, oh, hey, how you doing? Good to see you. And then the moment you turn your back, buddy, they've got a knife. And they're ready to stab you. There are people who will try to tarnish your reputation. There are people that will try to take what is rightfully yours. Nationally speaking, listen, we are observing Memorial Day tomorrow. It's a day that is set aside to remember our fallen countrymen and women who have given their lives to protect the freedom that we have in our nation. Who are they protecting us from? They're protecting us from people that wanted to take that freedom away from us. And as the church, listen, we have brothers and sisters all over the world who right now at this moment, or could be at any moment, incarcerated for proclaiming the name of Jesus Christ. The name that we freely speak openly. They're being incarcerated for speaking his name. In this country right now, there are efforts to silence freedom of religion because to some, religious beliefs are considered to be hate speech. We have these feelings of insecurity as we not only look at the harm that could be done to us, but we also have feelings of insecurities about our own bodies, don't we? Here's what I mean by that. We get older, and we face new health issues every day. yesterday. We were getting new furniture yesterday, and my father-in-law came down and was helping me carry furniture. This stuff was heavy, man. I mean, it was heavy. And my father-in-law is like, I don't know, 16, 17 years older than me. And he said, oh yeah, no problem. Well, he had had a heart attack a few years ago. And as he's carrying the furniture, he's sweating. It's getting difficult for him to do it. And we carry a piece, and he'd say, okay, well, I got to rest for a little while. And later he began to tell me, man, just when I, just 10 years ago doing this, I wouldn't have sweat a bit. And now it's killing me, right? When our bodies begin to break down, it brings about insecurities in our life. And maybe it's not us. Maybe it's someone we love, like a mom or a dad or a grandparent, a husband or a wife. And they begin to face these health issues. Sometimes it's even our children, isn't it? And it breaks our hearts, and it brings about some insecurities when they face physical difficulties and issues. And the thought of losing a loved one like that, the thought of dying ourselves, can lead to some tremendous thoughts of insecurity, some tremendous fears. So how is it that this reality, that God is present with us, and our awareness of God's presence can help us in the midst of all of these insecurities? How does that help us? I think about the Apostle Paul. I think about when the Apostle Paul was in prison in the early 60s, and Paul is, quite frankly, facing execution because of his faith, because of his inability to keep quiet about the gospel. Paul is facing execution. And while he's sitting in prison and quite possibly facing execution, he writes this wonderful letter that we know as the book of Philippians. And in the midst of that insecure situation, he doesn't know if he's going to be dead in a couple of hours or not. Paul writes these words. He says, "For me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain." Right? Paul looks at his situation. He says, you know what? If they let me keep on living, man, that's awesome. That means the message of Jesus Christ is going to continue to go out by my mouth. I can continue to serve Christ. I can continue to make him known. I can continue on the mission that God has given me. But realizing that may not be what happens, Paul says, if they kill me, you know what? I'm okay with that too. Because if I die, I'm going to see my Jesus face to face, and I'm going to experience the presence of my Lord in a way that is completely unexplainable. In fact, Paul says, just another verse down, Paul says, even I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better. Notice how Paul views his immediate circumstance. Because of his awareness that he is secure in God and in God alone, and his awareness that God is present with him both now and forevermore, Paul can look at his circumstances and he can say, to live is Christ and to die is gain. Either way, I am secure in the Lord. Either way, my Lord is with me. In either way, I am in the presence of my Savior. There's a contentment there. There's a security there that is not based on our circumstances. It wasn't based on the circumstances around him. It was based upon whom he trusted. It was based upon his trust in God alone, what God has done for him, who God is, and what God has promised to do. I love how Psalm 125 ends. It ends with this very simple statement. He says, peace be on Israel. I want you to notice the flow of the psalm. It starts off by saying, those who trust in the Lord are secure. They're secure because the Lord is with them both now and forevermore. He surrounds them like the mountains surround Jerusalem. God is with his people and he is surrounding his people. Then the psalmist continues to say, but despite God being with us, the world is a tough place, man. There's a lot of insecurities, a lot of evil in the world. There's a lot of people trying to get you. There's a lot of difficulties that you've got to face. And then the psalmist takes that initial reality that God is with his people, surrounding his people, he combines it with the reality that there's evil in the world, and he brings them together and he says, you know what? Peace be on Israel. The security of God trumps the insecurity of the world every day, every time. Peace be on Israel. And that last statement, the psalmist basically says, relax. Relax. We're secure. God is seated on the throne of ultimate power. Our feelings of depression, our suffering, nothing in the world is evidence that God has or ever will abandon his people. Our life with God is a sure thing because Jesus Christ has secured it for us. He is the faithful one. He is our champion of our faith. He is the forerunner of our faith. God is and will always remain God. And can I tell you something? He will always be faithful. God is aware of what is going on in the world around you. He is aware of what's going on in your world. And even more than that, God is present with you through it. So relax. Peace be on Israel. And so at the beginning, I asked the question, is the search for security a valid search? Do we need to seek security out? To be honest, I think it's a part of the human condition that as humans, we're always going to seek out security. But as Christians, as God's people, we have got to ask ourselves this question. Where do we truly find our security? And that, I believe, is the challenge of life. There's a plethora of voices out there that surround us, voices that come from our peers, from our friends, from our family, voices that come from media and television and movies and books and the internet. There are voices from every possible source. And all of these places are speaking into our hearts, trying to tell us, trying to convince us where we are to find our security. You find our security in money. We find our security in the car we drive, in the house that we live in the way we look, in how pretty or how ugly we are, in our ability, in our athletic ability, in the ability of our brains to process information and our ability to use technology. There's all of these different voices trying to tell us this is how you find security. The greatest challenge, I think, in forming our identity as the people of God is to black out all of those other voices and to listen to the one voice that comes from right here. And to allow God's voice to just black out all of those other voices. The clear and consistent message of the Bible is that security can only truly be found in a relationship with God through Jesus Christ, period. We can only truly experience security in life whenever we trust in the life, the death, and the resurrection of Christ. Romans chapter 8 proclaims this, verse 35, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. We are only truly secure in a relationship with God through Christ. And as the people of God, our challenge is to become increasingly aware of the reality that God is present with us, that we're in the palm of his hand, that he's surrounding us, and there's no circumstance on this earth that could ever change that. Sermon on the Mount. Jesus makes the statement. He says, you know what? Don't worry about tomorrow. Tomorrow's going to take care of itself. Be present in the moment right now. God is with you. God is with you. This morning, here's the deal. I don't know what circumstances of life are surrounding you. I know some. I do know some. But I don't know if maybe perhaps your health is failing you. Maybe the health of someone you love is failing. Maybe perhaps it's, you don't know if you're going to have a job tomorrow. Maybe perhaps the bank is really coming down on you about your house payment, and you don't know if you're going to have a house to live in next year. I don't know what circumstances are surrounding you. But I do know this. You can relax. God's in control. And can I tell you something? That situation, that circumstance, it may not come out the way you think it ought to. And you may look up to the sky and say, God, what are you doing? This doesn't make any sense whatsoever. But the same God that we trust in for our security, because he is all powerful, is also all wise. And he knows exactly what you need. He knows exactly what I need. And just like a son or a daughter will grip and hold the hand of their father or mom tightly because that's what gives them a sense of security, that's who we ought to be in this world. Holding the hand of our Father. Gripping tightly as we can. Knowing that he's with us, that he surrounds us, and we are secure in him and in him alone. Let's pray again.